welcome back. We're talking about the foundations of information technology and some of the definitions and history of where the internet and the technology that we have come from. What we haven't talked about is some of the words that are thrown around in IT circles. So let's talk about some of those. The first we should talk about is storage terminology. You may have heard it said that at the very foundation of computers, there are zeros and ones. And that's true. The zeros and ones are the foundation of all of the computer code, all the images, all the sounds that are stored and transmitted on the computer. And those zeros and ones are called bits. It's the smallest atomic unit of data that we work with in information technology. If you put eight of those together, you call that a byte. And those are often put together in order to form things like letters and components of numbers. If you put 1,024 bytes together, that's a kilobyte. And that can be used for a useful way of referencing how large a file is on your hard drive. Well, as files get bigger, you might get to a megabyte, which is 1,024 squared bytes. You might get a gigabyte, which is 1,024 to the third bytes. And then if you want to continue, you can talk about terabytes, 1,024 to the fourth, petabytes, exabytes, zottabytes, and finally, the largest number that at least I'm familiar with is yottabytes. So if you have all of these terms that talk about different scales, and you should just understand that these aren't just double or triple, these are orders of magnitude more storage. And we'll try and reference some of these in a second. You might hear the term packet described. Packet is a collection of bytes that can be a variable length. And usually you talk about a packet as being a unit of data that's sent over a network. And it can be different sizes. So send a packet over the network means send a collection of bytes over the network. All right, so let's try and get some scale around those different terms, the gigabyte scales. All right, so for starters, a DVD that you might have a movie on can hold about 5 gigabytes. So you can think to yourself that a digital movie, when you're going to watch it, is about 5 gigabytes. If you want to see a Netflix movie, you have to send about 5 gigabytes of packets over the internet. If you wanted to get all of Wikipedia downloaded and have a copy of that on a computer near you, that would require about 6 terabytes. So the picture on the left here is a screenshot or an artist's rendition of a scene from James Cameron's movie Avatar. Avatar was a heavily digitally produced movie with a lot of computer-generated graphics, and it was the largest one at the time that had required the most storage of any movie at that time, and it's estimated about 1 petabyte of storage in order to keep all the digital models and rendering to produce that movie. Now, if you were to take all of Netflix master copies of movies that they have in their servers, it would require about 3 petabytes of storage. Now remember, this is the movies that you're going to watch as opposed to all the digital movies that were in Avatar. So 3 petabytes. If you go up to the next level, you go up to exabytes. The scale of that is about the amount of data that the internet transmits every month. And this is very rough, but you think that in 1 month over the entire planet, 150 exabytes of data are moved around the internet. And if you wanted to go up the next level and say, how big is a zettabyte? Well, if you were to record every single word that has ever been spoken by any person on the planet in all of history, recorded about 16 kilobytes fidelity, it would take about 42 zettabytes in order to store all of those conversations. So to try and give you an order of magnitude understanding of what those numbers correspond to. Network terminology has their own set of terms that we use. So you are familiar with using web browsers and typing in addresses into the top of the web browser. Well, when you type in an address at the top of a web browser, the technical term for what you're typing in is a URL, and that's an abbreviation that stands for Uniform Resource Locator. So for example, if I were to type in http://www.ics.uci.edu, that's a URL for the informatics department at the University of California, Irvine. There's something called the domain name system, and the domain name system is responsible for translating those basically human understandable URLs, for example, ics.uci.edu, and translating that to something called an IP address. IP address, in this case, IP stands for Internet Protocol, and in version 4 of that protocol, the one that we're most familiar with, an address is listed as 4 numbers in a row between 0 and 256, between 1 and 256, between 0 and 255. So for example, www.ics.uci.edu, that might map into 128, 195, 59, 193. IP addresses make sense to computers, but URLs make more sense to humans. And so the domain name system is an international system for translating those human-readable URLs into network numbers that computers can use for routing packets around the internet. All right. A network is often considered to consist of different players on the network, different nodes that act in different roles. So you may have heard the word client used. The client is what we call a computer on a network that uses services. It's usually like a customer in a store. A server is a computer on the network that provides services to clients. This is like when a customer goes into a store, you think of the customer as a client, and you think of the store as being a server. Google, for example, is a server, and your web browser is a client. A client-server architecture refers to the fact in which you're building some kind of a program, some kind of a service, in which many people interact with a central server in order to obtain that service. Search engines are like this. Online stores are like this. Most services that you interact with on the internet use a client-server architecture. An alternative architecture is a peer-to-peer architecture. A peer-to-peer architecture is a network in which there are no servers, per se. There are only clients that are connecting to each other to collectively provide some kind of a service to each other. If you're familiar with online file sharing applications, which are mostly used for copyright infringement, trading movies, trading music, things like that, those are often a peer-to-peer arrangement of computers. The good thing about peer-to-peer arrangements is they tend to be more robust. And the trade-off between efficiency and robustness is a recurring theme that we have in this class. So peer-to-peer architectures can be very robust. So for example, if we wanted to look up the IP address of www.google.com, what could we do? Well, we could use a utility on your computer called dig, and on here is a screenshot of what that would look like. And you can type in dig www.google.com, and if that dig utility is installed on your computer, you'll get back a report of what the internet addresses are that are associated with that URL. So in this case, we see that 74.125.224.80 is one of five different IP addresses associated with the URL google.com. So then you can go to the browser and you can type in that address directly, and you see that actually, even though you didn't type in www.google.com, you get the Google search page. And that's because those computer addresses are still valid. It's just not very helpful for us to remember that specific set of numbers in order to get the services that we want. Another definition that we need to be clear on is the idea of what software is. As our world has gotten more mobile, as we have more cloud-based services, software has gotten a little bit more difficult to describe. But basically, in a nutshell, software is a set of instructions that tell hardware what to do. And increasingly, software can also be a set of instructions that tell other software what to do. So an example of this is a web browser. A web browser is an example of a piece of software, and a web page is an example of a piece of software that tells the browser what to do. In the beginning, we talked a little bit about that quote by Steve Jobs. I guess that was in the previous lecture. And just like we saw that technology is made by people, people also write the software that end up being run on our computers. People use special programming languages to write software. Nowadays, we often call that software apps. Apps is short for applications. Traditionally, those things were called programs, and they ran on desktop computers. Apps we typically associate with mobile computers. We use special software called compilers to convert the things that people write in programming languages into language that the hardware uses. So compilers convert software into machine-readable code that computers can run. Once a program is compiled and packaged, then it can be run on the computer. The people that do that are called software developers. And each computing environment that you might work with requires unique compilers and packaging equipment. So if you want to write a program for a Windows computer, you're going to need a special set of software to write your program, to compile it and package it so that it can run on a Windows computer. An iPhone, a different set of software. Android, yet another set of software that all are required in order to create the applications. Example programming languages include things like Python, Ruby, JavaScript, HTML, C#, Objective-C, and Java.